So now you've just had midterm exam one and you had chapter six. So chapter six was our introductory chapter on contract law. And in that chapter, I told you that there are five required elements for a valid contract. And in chapter six, we looked at the first two required elements for a valid contract. So can you help me? Which ones they are? Anyone? All right. You either don't want to do it or you don't remember. So we looked at consensus as a first required element. And consensus is made of a valid offer and an effective acceptance. So consensus means meeting of the minds. The minds are met. The minds of the parties, the offeror and the offeree, they meet their minds when the offeree makes an offer and the offeree accepts that offer. So that's consensus. Meeting of their minds, valid offer, effective acceptance. And then we also saw consideration. So consideration is the mutual benefit, the mutual price to be paid. If only one party derives a benefit, it's not a valid consideration. It's a gratuitous benefit. The contract may be valid, but not enforceable. So both parties have to derive a benefit. So they were consensus and consideration. Today, we're looking at capacity, legality, and intention. So let's start with capacity. Now, capacity is a required element because the law understands that some parties, they may be more vulnerable in entering into business transactions, in entering into contracts. And because they are more vulnerable, at least the law believes so, they may receive some special protection. So the protection that is afforded to some parties is that they have their contracting capacity limited, so there's limit to it, or sometimes their capacity is eliminated completely. They don't have capacity at all. So that's what we're going to look at. So we're going to look at several parties, several categories of people, and then details on those. I'll actually be emphasizing the most important ones to you. So we start with minors and infants. So we could use those terms interchangeably. I could refer to either minors or infants. That's the same thing. So they are below the age of majority. Now, my question to you, what is the age of majority in BC? 19. That's correct. What's the age of majority in Alberta? 21, and guesses are fine. 18, that's right. So first important information here, age of majority is dependent on the province. Each province in Canada will have their own age of majority. So it's 19 in BC, and we are focusing on BC. So we'll have 19 as a reference. But just to tell you that in other provinces, the age of majority is different. So what happens when minors or infants enter into contracts? They are not bound by the contract. Well, it means that the contract cannot be enforced on them. The law is protecting the minors. There are two main exceptions, and the two main exceptions are employment agreements and loan agreements, mainly student loans. So if they are using for their own study, then they are bound by those contracts. But all other contracts, they are not bound. So what I'm saying is, if I sell my smartphone to a miner, I deliver the smartphone today, and then the miner will pay me on Friday. If it's Friday and they don't pay me, I cannot enforce the contract on them because they are protected by the law. It doesn't mean the contract is illegal. No, it's not illegal. It's valid. And in most situations, miners, they do comply with their obligations. Yes, they do. But if they don't, what we need to remember is that if they don't, we, the adult or the company, we cannot enforce on them. Now, because you know this, what would you do in the same situation? So you are about to sell your smartphone to a miner. What would you do so that you avoid that the miner fails to pay you?
You make an agreement with the parents instead of the miner.
Okay, you make an agreement with the parents. That's a good one. But you are actually selling to the parents then. So what we could do is we could have the parents to sign the purchase agreement along with the minor, or could be parents or guardians. In other words, the parents, they are not buying the smartphone. It is the minor that is buying their child. However, they are guaranteeing the transaction. And when they guarantee, they are not liable unless the minor breaches the contract. Then they become liable. So yes, when parties function as guarantors, if the primary party, like the minor in this example, fails or breaches, then you can go after the guarantor. So yes, that's a good alternative. You would have the parents sign the agreement with you. And I say sign, so you should remember this information for later on. I say sign because guarantees in law, such as this one, guarantees in law, they have to be in writing. So if a minor says, oh no, let me call my parents, and they will confirm that if I don't pay you on Friday, they will pay you. You will say, hey, have you not attended BLaw at BCIT with João? João explained very clearly that your parents' guarantee has to be in writing. So bring your parents here and they will sign for me. A phone call wouldn't work. Okay? So yeah, so that's a good one. What else could you do in the same situation? And do not overthink. So when you sell something, what can you do to avoid being in loss? One, two, three, no. Okay, so when we sell something, clear terms. Well, even if you have clear terms with the minor is not bound. So if the minor doesn't comply with their obligations, still, you cannot enforce on them. So one thing is a simple one. When you're selling something to a minor, get the payment right away or even upfront. Okay, I'm selling you the smartphone. Just give me the money. I'll give you the smartphone. Right? Yeah, just get payment upfront. Now, there's another situation. It may be that the miner has a credit card. And you would say, well, but credit card companies, they don't give credit cards to miners. Well, they may, as long as the miners are dependents on their parents. So their parents will be the client of the credit card company, and they will have a credit card issued to their children. So if you can get payments through credit cards, just have the miner pay with a credit card. If the miner doesn't pay the credit card bill, it's not your business. So what I'm trying to tell you is that, okay, you learn that minors are protected. They are not bound. The agreement is still legal. In most situations, they do comply with their obligations. But if they don't, the adult or the company, they cannot enforce in the minor. So because you're taking this course from a legal risk perspective, this is what I expect you to learn, that whenever you enter into a transaction with a minor, either have it guaranteed by parents or guardians, or get payment, or get them to do their obligation, comply with their obligation up front. Because if they don't, and if they fail later on, you cannot enforce on them. Now, let me also add this to you. So I sold a smartphone to a minor. They would pay me on Friday. It's Friday, they haven't paid to me. I cannot enforce on them. But if the smartphone is defective, the minor can sue me. Why? Well, because I am bound by the agreement and I sold a workable or a working phone, a phone that is working. So if there's any issue with the phone, the minor, even though they have complied with their obligations, they can enforce my obligations because I am an adult. And as an adult, the contract is binding on me. So keep that in mind when you transact or try to transact with a minor. So I told you the exceptions, student loans, and contracts of employment. Now, when the minor becomes an adult, if they keep on in the contract, let's say they are in a continuous contract or in a long-term contract, they have a smartphone, a cell phone service contract. So when they become an adult, the day they turn the age of majority, if they continue on receiving the benefit of the contract, it means they have ratified the contract. They have confirmed the contract. From that time on, they are bound. If they fail to comply with their obligations, yes, the company or the adult can enforce on them. Okay, so that's ratification. Now, parents are not responsible for the minor's contracts. No, unless parents or guardians, they guarantee the transactions. And remember, guarantees have to be in writing. Now, you remember that parents, they are liable for their children's torts, some of them, but they are not liable for their minors or children's contracts unless they guarantee. So keep that in mind. Now, minors, they are also liable for their own torts. However, and because of this, and also because adults or companies cannot go after minors through breach of contract. So what happens is adults or companies, they try to go after minors through tort, even though they were in a contractual relationship. So they try to get away this limitation from suing the minor under contract, and they try to sue under tort. Well, what the courts say is that if it's a separate tort, separate from the contract, it's not a tort related to the breach of contract, then it is okay. But if there was a breach of contract and a tort, no, because the breach of contract bars the adult or the company to go after the minor. So an example would be the minor rents a car and they cannot travel to the US, they travel to the US. So they breach the agreement. And then they are involved in an accident, they cause losses, etc. The rental car cannot go after the minor. Why not? Because there was a breach of contract. So the breach of contract bars the rental car company to go after the minor, even though there was a tort. Now, the minor, a second example would be the minor rented a car again. But the minor didn't go to the US. The minor just drove the car within Lower Mainland. So there's no breach of contract. And the minor was involved in an accident or through the car caused damages, losses to others. Well, then there's a separate tort. It's not related to a breach of contract because there was no breach of contract. In this second example, yes, the rental car company could go after the minor under tort law. But not under, they wouldn't go under breach of contract because there was no breach of contract. So this would be two examples here. One where there was both a breach and a tort, no lawsuit possible against the minor. And the second one when there was only a tort, committed by the minor, then yes, the rental car company could go after them. All right, so that's on the minors. Now, there are other parties that are also protected by the law. And this other party will be whoever is insane or intoxicated. And here the rules are the same, even though insanity is different from intoxication, but the rules in law, they are the same. Well, what happens? Someone who is insane, someone could be temporarily insane or permanently insane, someone who is intoxicated, the law understands that they do not understand the nature of the transaction because they are not in their better mind or conscious level. So they don't understand what the transaction is. They don't have understanding of the nature. And the other party, they know, or they should have known, that they are taking advantage of this situation, of this insanity, of this intoxication. So whenever a drunk person or an insane person enters into a contract, and as long as the other party knew or should have known, when I say should have known, I mean the other party had signs or had information that the other party was drunk or was intoxicated or was insane. So if it is the case, the contract is void. Well, why it's void? And it's void, it's null. So the contract will be canceled by the courts. Okay? Because the party took advantage of the intoxicated one, the insane one. But now keep that in mind. If you were ever intoxicated, for example, and you enter into a contract, you would have to prove in court you were intoxicated, but also that the other party knew you were intoxicated, or they should have known. They were told by a friend that you were drunk, or they saw you behaving as a drunk, etc. What I mean here, it's not enough to prove that you were intoxicated. You must prove that the other person knew or should have known. Because if they didn't know or they should not have known, in principle, they have not taken advantage of you. They didn't know. They enter in a contract with you. Okay? So those two requirements are needed. Now, for example, you go to a bar with a friend, or let's say you go to a casino with a friend, you start drinking, you drink heavily, your friend doesn't drink, so they know you are getting intoxicated, you run out of money, and then you offer your smartphone for sale to your friend for $200, and it's a $1,000 worth smartphone, and your friend takes advantage of your situation because you want to gamble more, and you are drunk, and you think it's okay to sell your smartphone for $200. Well, in this situation, most likely courts would void the contract. Okay. Now, the same example, you are in a casino, you are gambling, but you are not drunk, and none of you is drunk. Then if the same transaction happens, most likely the court will not void the contract. You sold for $200. Or even if you drank, or even if you're drunk, but you are not behaving as a drunk, and your friend was not there, your friend just arrived, so they don't know you are drunk or you are not behaving as drunk, so they don't know how much you have drunk. So in the second example, it would be more difficult for you to have that contract voided in court because you would have a hard time establishing the second requirement that the other person knew or should have known you were drunk. So that's insanity and intoxication. Questions? Okay, don't see anything. All right. So now some other parties, I'll mention some other parties. So corporations, well, in principle, corporations, they have full capacity. Companies, they can enter into any contracts. Now, but it may be the case that the directors of the corporation or the shareholders of the corporation, they limited the capacity of the corporation. For example, shareholders, they can say that the corporation cannot do business with government companies. I don't know, maybe shareholders don't like that governments may delay payment, or there may be suspicion of corruption, bribery, etc. So in principle, corporations have full capacity, but directors or shareholders, they may limit the capacity. How do you know? Well, you should ask for the corporation's documents. In most transactions, contracts will have a clause, a section, in which the corporation says that they warrant, they represent, that they have capacity to enter into that transaction. So if they are lying, then you will have a remedy. So in most situations, you don't ask for their corporate documents, internal corporate documents. But when there's an investment transaction, then investors, they want to see the corporate documents in their due diligence process. So they would see that. So that's about corporation. Crown bodies, so governmental companies, their capacity may or may not be limited. How do we know? Well, if it's a crown body, if it's a governmental corporation, they were created by the law, by legislation, by regulation. So you have to look at that law, to that legislation, and assess whether there's any capacity limitation or not. Some other want to mention. So for indigenous people, bankrupts, they have limited capacity because they are bankrupt. And for indigenous, one thing I want to mention here is that if land belonging to First Nation peoples, if land is on a reserve, that land cannot be used as a security, because that land cannot be seized by the creditor. So this is a kind of limitation. They also have limits, the bands, First Nations bands, they need to pass a resolution. So the band needs to approve certain transactions. So it depends on the rules of each band or First Nation peoples. So some limitations there. All right, so just before this question, we've just finished this third required element, which is capacity. So capacity is not necessarily something that is either there or not there. No, capacity is related to the condition of the parties. And in general, or as a general rule, parties, they have full capacity. Now, there are issues with minors, infants, because their capacity is limited. They do have capacity, but they are not bound, except for employment or student loans. Then insane and intoxicated, they have no capacity at all to enter into contracts while they are in such situation. And then we saw corporations and indigenous peoples. So we need to assess whether that party has capacity or not. Now, question for you to practice. What do you think? D, E, D, okay, so it's either D or E Okay, so let's read together. So Ted is a miner, was hired to perform. So it's a an employment to perform. Okay, so to keep up with his schoolwork and gaming, he contracted with Mr. Tech of Technoland. So it's a company for a $2,000 laptop. He agreed to pay $500 down and the balance by monthly payments of $250. Okay, so which one is true? If Ted doesn't make his payments, Ted can sue Ted's parents because parents are liable. Is this true? Are parents liable? No, they are not liable unless they have signed as guarantors. But here, nothing is saying about guarantors. So A is not right. This contract is void. Is it void? No, it's not a void contract. It's a legal contract. It's not void. If this contract is in writing and Ted doesn't make payments, Ted can sue Ted for, well, I didn't mention anything about writing or not. And we learned in chapter 6 that verbal agreements are as valid as written ones. So no, C doesn't make sense. Oh, sorry. So this contract is a legal contract enforceable by Ted. Is this enforceable by Ted? Can Ted enforce against Mr. Tech? Can the minor enforce against a company or against an adult? The answer is yes. Yes, they can enforce. That's what I told you. The contract is not enforceable on the minor, but it's enforceable on the company, on the adult. So yes, it's enforceable. D is right. This contract is a legal contract. Enforceable against Ted? No, it's not enforceable against Ted. The minor is not bound by the contract. So D is the right answer. Okay. And by the way, the idea to have those questions in the lecture, some of them, is also to help you navigate, and I can help you solve the question and review and answer questions. So that's my objective too here. All right, so let's move on. Now we're going to talk about the fourth required element, which is legality. So we've talked about consensus. We've talked about consideration. We've just talked about capacity. Now, legality. Well, legality, there are two things we need to look at. First of all, performance. So you see the title of the slide. Contracts performed illegally. When the contract is legal, but performance is illegal. So in some cases, the court will enforce the contract. For example, I am a construction company. I was hired to build a house. It's a legal contract, but I am performing my contract. I am building the house without a building permit. Oh, I am performing it illegally. But it's the case, or it's possible for me to correct that illegality because I need to act fast and obtain that building permit. So in that case, courts would allow for the contract to be corrected and enforce it as it is, because it's an illegality in performance that can be corrected. Now, there are situations in which the performance, the illegal performance, cannot be corrected. If you hire me as a lawyer, I am not a Canadian lawyer. I cannot correct it overnight. I need to study. I have already done that, but I need to go articling. I haven't done that. And articling is minimum 9 months. And I have to be called to the bar. So only licensed lawyers can practice the law. If you hire me as a lawyer, it's a legal contract. However, my performance is illegal and cannot be corrected. So in this case, courts would cancel the contract. Courts would restore the parties to their original position. If you had paid me anything, I would have to return that money to you. because the illegality in performance is so serious that cannot be corrected. So courts will help the victim here. Okay? So that's about performing a contract illegally. The contract itself is legal, as I exemplified, construction contract, legal services, but for the construction, the illegality could be corrected more easily. If it couldn't, then it would be void, but usually it is possible to correct. The lawyer or the professional who is not a lawyer, they cannot practice law. So that cannot be corrected. The same for a doctor. A professional that is not a doctor cannot provide doctor's services. So in this case, courts would cancel the contract and restore the parties to their original position. Now, the second aspect of legality is related to formation. So see here, we talked about performance. Now formation. When the contract is entered into, and it's entered into illegally. How are contracts, so the contract itself, as I'm saying there, the contract itself is illegal. When does this happen? Well, it happens when the subject matter of the contract is illegal or immoral, unacceptable. Examples here, drug deals, prostitution. So for example, my friends bought cocaine. They used cocaine. Cocaine was of bad quality. They wanted to sue the drug dealer. I told them, hey, the contract you entered into is an illegal contract because it has an illegal subject matter. You took your risks. Courts will not help you. You knew the subject matter was illegal. So courts will not help you. Okay. Some other examples. When there's a contract to commit a crime or a tort, immoral acts, prostitution, as we just said, or to fix prices. Imagine two companies, they work together to fix prices so that they affect competition, so that clients, consumers do not have free competition, or there's no free competition in the market. If you want that product, you have to pay that price. So it's known as cartel. This is also illegal, okay? So for example, if I don't like my neighbor, I hire a killer to kill my neighbor. Then our payment terms will be, I will make a down payment. Then after my neighbor is killed, I will pay the balance. Now, my neighbor was killed. The killer came to get the balance payment. And I said, no, I'm not paying you. It's an illegal contract. And I know you cannot sue me. Right? So when the subject matter is illegal, the contract itself is illegal. I know what you're thinking of. You're thinking that the killer would not want to sue me. They would want to kill me too. It's just a joke. But if you enter into such a contract, the contract itself is illegal. So it's void. It doesn't produce any effects. Okay? So two aspects to consider. Performance and formation. Okay? Now, restrictive covenants. What are they? So restrictive covenants, examples will be confidentiality, provisions, non-competition, non-solicitation. So with a restrictive covenant, one party is trying to limit the ability of the other party to do something. Now, let's think about business relationship. Let's think about, let's say, I am buying a pet shop. So the seller, I want the seller, or I want to limit the seller's ability to compete with me because I am buying their pet shop. So I don't want them to use the money or whatever money they have to start a new pet shop just next door or close by. Because if they do so, they will compete with me. So what about my investment? So it is fair to limit the ability of others to either compete with you or to solicit on former clients, employees, suppliers, and also to disclose confidential information. Now, this limitation has to be reasonable, and reasonable in terms of time limit and also geographic limit. In other words, if I'm buying a pet shop, let's say close to BCIT, Burnaby, well, it's reasonable that I limit the capacity of the seller to start a new pet shop in central Burnaby, because it's a pet shop. People don't drive long to go to a pet shop. But it's not reasonable if I limit the seller's ability to start a pet shop anywhere in the Lower Mainland, or even anywhere in BC or anywhere in Canada. No, this is not reasonable. And why do we say reasonable? Well, because I, as a buyer, I'm trying to protect my investment. And also with regards to time. So for a pet shop, I would say it's reasonable to limit the ability of the sellers to compete with me or to solicit in about a year and a half, two eventually, but not more than that. Because if I haven't been able to make my own clientele, my own way of working in one and a half years, well, the market is free. Anyone can start a new business. So the message here is that restrictive covenants, they are allowed. What are they? They are limitations. So they attempt to limit the ability of one of the parties to do something. And in this case, to disclose confidential information, to compete, and to solicit. However, those limitations, they are allowed by the courts when they are reasonable with regards to time limit and geographic limit. Okay. Now, those restrictions, they also exist in employment agreements. And in employment agreements, because they are related to the ability of the former employee to work for a competitor, to do their own life, to make their own living. So the limits are much more strict. And actually, in Ontario, for example, the law has prohibited non-competition. So in Ontario, non-competition cannot be used anymore. A former employee can go work for a competitor right away after they leave a company. Okay? So that's what restrictive covenants are. All right, so let's stop here. Let's pause here. 10-minute break. And then we'll resume to finish chapter 7. Okay, so we've just talked about legality, and we're now about to finish the fifth required element for a valid contract. So to help you memorize, we went through consensus, valid offer, and effective acceptance. We've gone through consideration, mutual benefit, capacity. Some parties are more vulnerable than others, so they have either limited or eliminated capacity. We went through minors, infants, intoxicated, insane, and some others. And we just discussed legality. A contract may be performed illegally. It's a legal contract, but performed illegally. Or the contract itself may be illegal, in which the subject matter is either illegal or unacceptable against the moral. It's immoral. So now let's look at intention. Okay, so intention, it's straightforward. So intention says that parties, they intend to be bound by those terms. They intend to be in the transaction. And why do I say it is straightforward? Because the law presumes that in commercial relationships, the intention is presumed. There's intention there. So not an issue. Now, what is key for us is that in some other situations, such as social relationships or domestic relationships, there's a presumption of no intention. Well, what are social relationships or domestic relationships? Well, they are relationships in which social, like professional and client, or could be a religious leader and religious follower, could be instructor and students. So those are examples of social relationships or family relationships, such as parents and children, grandparents and grandchildren, well, family. Now, in those relationships, there's a presumption of no intention. In other words, when an instructor enters into an agreement with a student, there's a presumption of no intention. And if there's no intention, the contract is void. Because remember, one required element would be missing. However, that presumption can be rebutted. So it's saying here, if I'm not mistaken, no, not there. The presumption can be rebutted. This is in chapter 8. So what do I mean by rebutting that presumption? Well, if we show the court, so let's say I am selling my car to my daughter. Well, according to what I just told you, it's presumed to have no intention. So if my other daughter challenges in court that the contract is void, the court will presume it's void. However, my other daughter and I, we can show the court, for example, that my daughter actually needed a car. We can also show that my daughter paid a fair market value to that car. And also that my daughter had an opportunity to seek independent legal advice. So if we show this to court, most likely we'll be successful rebutting, setting aside that presumption of no intention. Then the contract would be legal, would be valid. Okay, so again, with regards to intention, it's a straightforward business relationships, there's intention. However, when we talk about social or domestic relationships, some other steps have to be taken. As I mentioned to you, the real need for that item, if it's a purchase, fair market value, and independent legal advice. Well, if there's an independent legal advice, at least an opportunity, then it's most likely that that presumption will be rebutted and intention will be there. So that's intention. Let's practice with regards to legality. Which one is correct? D. D is correct. Okay, so D is saying an agreement that one merchant won't open up a business in competition with another is enforceable as long as there is consideration on both parties. Consideration is required, but what else? What else is required? So won't open up a business in competition means the restrictive covenant. When are restrictive covenants enforceable? What are the requirements? Does anyone remember? It has to be reasonable in terms of geographic limit and time limit. So here it's just saying that is enforceable as long as there is consideration on both sides. Well, there has to be consideration, but also it has to be reasonable. So I wouldn't go for D. B. A first. A judge can refuse to enforce a contract that involves a conduct that is not prohibited, but which the court precedent considers morally unacceptable. So did I tell you that immoral contracts are illegal? Yes, I did. So even though it's not prohibited by law, but the court precedent, case law precedent, considers morally unacceptable. So yes, the judge may refuse to enforce. Okay, this is a correct statement. Let's look at B. When two merchants agree not to sell certain product and the product is not readily available from other sources, so only those two merchants will have the product. This is legally permissible. No, this is not. Remember, agreement to fix prices, not valid. So this B is not correct. C, insurance taken out on property you don't own is valid. Is it valid? No, it is not. If you don't own the property, you don't have an insurable interest, and it's not saying that you rent it. So in principle, this is not true. Again, so D, we already discussed, it's not valid because on the aspect of, on the top of consideration, there has to be a reasonable geographic limit, geographic and time limit. And E, an agreement where one party agrees to pay another to sue a third party for tort. No, if you pay someone to sue for a tort, no, you are paying someone to start a lawsuit. This is not valid. So this is a good question, which gives you examples of situations where the contracts are illegal. B, C, D, and E. The only one that is legal, this contract is also illegal, A, but it's a true statement. Why? Because even though the conduct is not prohibited by law, the precedent, court precedent, considers morally unacceptable. And if they consider morally unacceptable, it's a legal contract, not enforceable in court. Is this clear? Any questions? No questions, no comments. Okay, so now let's talk a little bit about the form of contract. So initially, chapter 6, I told you that verbal agreements are as valid as written ones. However, some transactions, the law says that the contract needs to be in writing, or it needs to have a written component, a written piece. Could be a note, could be an email, could be a receipt. The best example for us is transfer of land. When there's a transfer of land contract, purchase of a home, purchase of an apartment, townhome, land, it has to be in writing, or there has to be a written component. This written component could be, again, as I said, the actual agreement, the receipt, note, email. So if parties don't have a written component, the contract is still legal, but courts will not enforce it. Okay? Courts don't enforce contracts that should be in writing and are not. Now, what is another example that I gave you in the beginning of the lecture that has to be in writing? Does anyone remember when we were talking about capacity? I told you that one type of transaction should be in writing. Okay, it seems no one remembers, so get back there. Yes, Joyce, thank you. Parents guarantee. So guarantees, any types of guarantee, and I did talk about parents guarantee, but any types of guarantee in law has to be in writing. So giving you two examples, transfer of land and parents guarantee, they have to be in writing. There are others here. So contracts that are longer than 1 year, guarantees, as I said, and some others here. Now, remember, if there's no written component, it doesn't mean the contract is illegal. No, it's not illegal. It's legal, but it's not enforceable in courts. Okay. There's an exception here for, I'll be back here, for partial performance when there's a contract of land. So if I buy land, let's say I buy your apartment and I do it verbally, we do it verbally and it should be in writing. Well, if we have a partial performance, for example, if you have given me access to the land, to the apartment, to start renovation, well, court would consider that partial performance as something that would allow them to enforce the contract. So in principle, we did this orally. Orally wouldn't be enforceable. It's still valid, but not enforceable. However, if I need to enforce the contract, and if I show partial performance of that contract, even though I have no written piece, courts would enforce. So that's an exception of this written requirement here. Partial performance would be there. Now, with regards to electronic contracts, we discussed this already in chapter 6. So electronic documents, they have legal effect. They are as valid as written ones, and they are also enforceable. So examples would be when you think about terms and conditions. So by purchasing this product, by clicking here, you accept the terms and conditions. Well, terms and conditions are an example of an electronic agreement. So they are valid and enforceable. All right, so we're finishing here the five required elements for a valid contract. So we looked at consensus. If there's no consensus, the contract is void. We looked at consideration. If there's no valid consideration, the contract is void. We looked at capacity. Well, the contract may be voidable, or the contract may be void, depending on the issue with capacity. So with infants, the contract is voidable. With insane or intoxicated, the contract is void. They have no capacity at all. And then if the contract is illegal, it is void. if the contract itself is illegal, but it could be that performance is illegal, so the contract may be either void or voidable. And if the contract has no intention, the contract is void. But remember that in business relationships, there's a presumption of intention. However, in social or domestic relationships, there's a presumption of no intention. So parties need to take extra steps, such as seeking independent legal advice and others, to rebute that presumption. And if the contract should be in writing, but it's not in writing, it's still a valid contract, but it's not enforceable. Unless you show the courts that there was partial performance. But remember that only specific transactions should have a written component, not all. Because verbal agreements are as valid as written ones. So summarizing what we saw, capacity, legality, intention, well, I just summarized, and the form of contract. So that's chapter 7 on the other three required elements. I'll stop recording.